Bonjour, bonjour, and hello, welcome to the live podcast for the Women's Tour edition 2022. And it's the episode 3 of this year's edition. And we are seeing a very nice tour developing on the roads of Britain. Joining us, as per usual, it's Gracie Elvin. How are you, Gracie?
Bonjour, Christophe. I'm very well, thank you. And yeah, it's been a great week of racing so far, but I think it's going to get a lot more interesting.
We know the mountains are coming, and we know the hilltops at least are coming. There's a couple of very tough stages ahead. But yesterday was a day for the sprinters. We go all over that stage. And joining us as well is Kate Bates. How are you, Kate?
Yes, good evening. I think that this tour is getting more exciting by the day, which is good. And by the way, if we hear a creak, I've just noticed my chair sounds like it needs some WD-40. That's not my knees or my back. at this stage in the tour, but just a heads up.
What's the name of the oil you put when it's a wet weather oil, you know, on the mountain
like
bikes, on the chain?
WD-40 or something, or like...
I'm not sure,
sewing machine oil is what we used to use, but there's probably better products for it now.
Yeah. So yesterday was stage 2 of the Women's Tour of Britain. Let's go back and have a look at the last kilometre.
So Eleanor Backstead now takes over for Trek Segafredo, but here come Bike Exchange Jayco as they move themselves up into position. And Bike Exchange Jayco, Ari Fidanza is the rider that's right on the wheel of Alex Manley as Audrey Cordon-Rago takes over. Tanyan Schramm trying to lead out for Shari Bossit. There's Corinne Lebecki in that yellow jersey as well. You can see just a little bit further back. Capone, though, a race leader, is poised and ready. But here come Trek Segafredo with Chloe Hosking. And then you've got the two riders from DSM with Loretta Wiebes right there through the Flam Rouge with 1 kilometer to go. And Audrey Cordon-Rago hands over to Elisa Longa Borghini, the power of the Italian champion, with Chloe Hosking right there. But there is Wiebes. She's wearing number 12. You can see in that black jersey. And right behind her, Barbara Goryski of Team Movistar. As here come the reinforcements now for Loretta Wiebes.
Francisca Koch just opening up here on the right-hand side, just trying to accelerate to open things up for Lorena Wiebes. And take a look on the right-hand side. Here comes Micah van der Doorn, Christine Majeres just getting pushed out there. And Francisca Koch, take a look at that. Perfect piloting for Lorena Wiebes. And Barbara Goryski, she's locked into the wheel of the Dutch woman.
Marjolein van Galoof is there as well, but Lorena Wiebes poised and ready to make a move. Shari Bossit, but now Wiebes, that turn of speed. Look at the turn of speed and the power of Lorena Wiebes. Gaps the rest of the bunch in that sprint. It's going to be a stage victory on day 2. Wiebes takes it from DSM. Goryski takes second for Team Movistar.
Absolutely incredible turn of speed there by Lorena Wiebes. When she kicked, no one could reply to that power.
That was quite a finish, Kate. Lorena Wiebes, that kick created that gap straight away. There was no going back for anyone else.
No, look, she's so classy. She won 3 out of 3 stages at Ride London last week, and we knew she was in form. Stage 1 got a bit kafooed for her with that whole crash at the front coming into that last corner. We were done and dusted with that yesterday. Today was always going to be a very big stage for DSM because they do head into the nasty, nasty British mountains in the next couple of days. But listen, Christophe, 45 UCI wins to date. She's arguably the fastest rising sprinter in the women's field. I reckon she's got her eye on those 4 flat stages of the Tour de France Femme. In fact, I reckon she's got her eyes on the first ever Maillot Jaune for the women's Tour de France Femme in this iteration. So I think she's just coming into form. It's no surprise to me. It's a 9th win of the season. Gracie, last year we saw her do some pretty impressive things, but this year already with Schelde de Prize and Ronde van Drenthe, we know that not only can she sprint, but in really tough conditions. And this kind of suits her to a T.
Gosh, there was a lot to unpack there in that sprint, but there's no doubt about who was fastest. You know, she just had such a huge gap at the end there. She's been rapid all season. I think she's definitely the fastest woman in the peloton at the moment in a straight line, and that was definitely a straight line sprint, much less complicated than stage 1. And she had some great team support too. So interestingly, she had 2 riders there leading her out, but not together. She had a really great lead out in one rider that took her, you know, to that a few hundred meters to go, and another rider had come up, which was actually an amazing effort to come up alongside, open the door a little bit, and then take it to the next level with her sprint, that she could jump on the tail of and then just launch and get away from everyone. Mm-hmm. So overall, it was quite an impressive performance from Team DSM. You don't see that play out that often, that scenario, because it's quite risky to have someone coming from behind to hopefully help. You don't really want to leave it that late, but they managed it. And it was really cool to watch. And it was really interesting to see the dynamic between some of the other teams too that were doing arguably better lead outs, but they just kind of just ran out of gas.
Mm-hmm. And Kate, how much of the crash from yesterday, the taking the hold to DSM riders pretty much close to the finish, how much of that played in that victory last night?
Yeah, I don't think it affected DSM too much at all. But who I did see it affecting was Jumbo Visma, and Corinne Lebecki finished a bit further back than I imagined she would. Now, her lead out rider, Caroline Swinkel, she also went down. She may have even been one of the first to go down in that crash. And was the one we saw catapult through the barriers. Never a nice thing to see. She finished nearly 4 minutes down today, which suggests to me that she was in a bit of a world of hurt. Now, Corinne, we don't know how she bundled up after that, but she certainly lost her team support in that lead out. I think that played into the hands of DSM. But Gracie put it perfectly, and maybe not even meaning the pun, but the massive lead out for Wives was Charlotte Cool. Spelt with a K, but cool all the same. And I reckon they're like the dream team at the moment, because you don't often see riders with those kind of attributes finding themselves so well in the bunch and with really similar engines. So I think that they're kind of just getting warmed up.
And Gracie, question for you here. We know the impact the DSM team has on the men's peloton. They're a bit on the edge in terms of their training. They're a bit on the edge about the riders they're bringing up and so on. We know Jai was there, for example. Romain Bardet is now there. They're very sort of a different outfit. Is this the same on the women's peloton? Do they have the same impact as they have on the men's peloton, on the women's peloton?
They actually do. They're a really interesting team and quite a unique team. Some riders fit in super well there and others don't. They have quite a regimented formula for their coaching. You have to be coached by their coaches. You know, I'm not sure if anyone's been able to get out of that from what I've heard. They often base all of the riders in the same area in, I think, in Limburg in the Netherlands. And they have quite good training camps. They just have a lot of discipline around that team. And, you know, they're now developing an Aussie rider in the men's team in Sam Welsford in those sprints. So, you know, they've taken talent over the years. Michael Matthews has been part of that squad too over the years. And some, you know, other riders they've signed as really young riders in the men's and the women's team for long contracts too, which is actually very unusual in women's cycling. Riders have signed for 3, 4, sometimes 5-year contracts.
Yeah, this is good to see, and it's probably great for the future as well to have this team investing so much, but keeping their identity from both sides of the checker of cycling. Let's take you to the actual podium. What happened straight after the stage?
Three to our podium, Lorena Wives. Let's celebrate our winner today. Unfortunately, going down in a crash yesterday with inside the finish, but makes no mistake today. Team DSM's Lorena Wives opens her account of this year's Women's Tour with a stage victory. And again, perfectly executed by DSM. So Clara Capone has defended that yellow jersey. So we'll take that into day three. So the FDJ Nouvelle Aquitaine Futuroscope rider. And again, those bonus sprints and those bonus seconds, this is where you start to see how important they are.
Across the two stages, she's collected 14 bonus seconds. So that just gives you some indication how important those bonus seconds are. And Capone relishing her time in the yellow jersey there.
So that was the podium yesterday. Two things. Yes, I've removed my scarf because it's actually a lot warmer in the studio than I thought when I first came in. Secondly, company in yellow, the mention here about the bonus points, it's super important. And Kate, you flagged that before the race even started.
Yeah, I mean, I think in years previous, we've had a lot come down to those bonus seconds, and so you really have to pay attention. This year may be a little bit different just because of the hills that are coming up and what may happen over there. But if they're not raced quite aggressively, we may see those bunches come back together in part where those bonus seconds can still play quite a part. And I also think it's really interesting, guys, how the local teams are really grabbing hold of those, what we could call minor jerseys. And for you, Christophe, very confusing jerseys because, of course, the green is for the climbing and the red is for the sprint here. So that's a little bit upside down and back to front, isn't it? But keep up, people. And so Lacole Wahoo are going very aggressively after both of those jerseys. They've got Vanderdown in that sprint jersey. Gladys Verhulst tried to take the climber's jersey overnight, didn't quite get there. She's now 1 point adrift of Christine Majeras from SD Works. And so I think it's really cool, like these smaller local teams are taking the opportunity to really step up. The interesting thing I note about that, though, is that they said they came in, that wasn't the plan when they came in. They just wanted to be proactive and, you know, to a degree get some TV time, which is all for the sponsors. We see that a lot, especially in the Giro. We talked about that a lot. The poor commentary team, my goodness, they ended up talking about some of these riders for hours and hours on end. But they went out just kind of hoping to be aggressive. They've ended up in jerseys or with jerseys. They've changed now. They'll be flat out defending them. And we'll talk about it in a little bit when we talk about tomorrow. But I think that that will really affect tonight's stage is raced.
Yeah, 100%. Gracie, there was a crush as well. Take us through that crush.
Oh, I really hope that Alex Manley's not reliving that crash of her very first tour into the bushes and into the ivy. But a lot of riders going down there, there's no reports of any serious injuries, but it did disrupt the chase of the breakaway of two riders later in the stage, which kind of made for a more exciting race. You don't want to see a crash, but they were only caught within the last few kilometres. And it's kind of fun if you're trying to decide whether it's going to go down to the line or not.
Yeah. You've got a sick sense of humor, Gracie Oven.
and Kate, did you have images of nettles in there?
Oh, I did. Look
your
at
phobia
them.
Of nettles.
Yes, look at them. It's like stinging nettles or lantana or all of those things my mother used to make me weed out of the garden. It's terrible. And what is it with ditches and bikes and people falling into ditches? Gracie's right, though. It did come at a really interesting time. When it happened at about 7K to go, there was only 28 riders remaining in that front group to chase those two leaders. So that disrupted that a fair bit. It did end up coming together in bulk, which, you know, thank goodness. But again, I think it just shows you, you've got to keep on your toes because it's not just that final couple of kilometres where they can keep bunch time. But certainly on these narrow roads, you know, if we've learned anything in the first 2 days, it's that, you know, there might be a few hazards out on the road, guys, and they kind of got to keep their eyes open.
And you can get stuck an hour if you are waiting for an ambulance to pass by as well. This is what we got. That's how narrow the roads are. talking about the narrow and how narrow the roads are, there was a sprint yesterday. We saw it. We saw it at the front. Pretty, I think, nasty at the back. Let's have a look. What do you think of this? Take us through, Kate, that sprint.
Well, you can see that Garishi, she's a Movistar rider, is fairly clearly impeding Shari Bossert, who we chatted about yesterday being an up-and-coming Sprinter Classics rider. Now, Bossert ends up putting her hand out to push Garishi away. I think there's a couple of things, and I reckon we might have some diverging opinions on this too, which kind of, you know, get out the popcorn. But I don't think Garishi necessarily did anything wrong. I think it's dirty sprinting and I don't have a lot of respect for that kind of sprinting, but it wasn't bad enough to get relegated, nor should it have been. And I think that Shari Bossert, if you're going to come up the inside like that and try and shoot the gap, which is perfectly legitimate, you've got to have the speed to do it. We see Caleb do it a fair bit and you've got to accelerate through that gap so that you are in a position where they can't impede like that. Now, very different if they swing into you, but Garishi didn't. Gracie, I'm curious as to what you think because I think it's not pretty to watch, but, you know, that's how you keep your second in a bike race.
I had to re-watch this sprint a few times to form a bit of an opinion. I have to say I'm a bit biased because this particular rider, Gracie, has been known to do this in the past. So I feel like I've been in that position before and I get annoyed about it. But in some ways, I do agree with you. If you're going to take that inside line on the fence, that's a highly risky thing to do. Sometimes riders get pushed by other riders, so it's just dangerous in general. I was kind of impressed that she took her hands off the handlebars at the end there to push Gracie away because, you know, that's a skill in itself. But, you know, I think when you're in that last 50 metres, you really need to be holding your line. And even though a tactic is to close the door, as they say in cycling, it's not the right thing to do.
Mm. Yeah, but I mean the bit where I would disagree is when we see them crossing the line, she's definitely closing it. She's definitely glowing and she's not keeping a straight line as well. She's really, you can see the head going this way. Is that correct?
Can you keep a straight line going 60 plus K an hour? I mean, I hear what you're both saying. And like I said, Gracie, I don't respect that kind of sprinting. And I've also been up against some people in my career who shall remain nameless unless, you know, somebody sends me a nice pot of flowers or something and then I'll spill the goss. But I hated sprinting against them and it changed the way I would sprint against them because I knew that that was their go-to tactic. And a lot of riders use that because they know that technically it's clean. Now, where do you walk the line with that? I don't know. I don't like it, but I don't, you know, I think it's going to keep happening and, the minute it causes a crash, it's a different story. It is a very fine line, isn't it? I mean, if Bossett had have fallen off, we'd be throwing our hands in the air and saying, chuck her out of the race.
Yeah, I would agree. Okay.
Let's hope she doesn't do it again, hey?
No, absolutely. This is the standing, or these are the standings for the different jerseys. Yes, you're right. They're still confusing to me, but that's okay. I'll live with them. And this is your top 10 here. Any surprises here, Kate? Do we see any, you know, anything that is surprising? Alison Jackson in top 8?
Oh, no, I think Alison Jackson, this is a kind of perfect tour for her, actually. But she's almost the rider that you see but don't see. But she's picked up some bonus seconds on stage one, which is why she's in the top 10. I think Maaike Vanderdaan in second and only a couple of seconds adrift of that GC. She's the one that people perhaps would not have looked at the beginning. But she's only 20. She hasn't had many really standout results yet, but she has been riding a lot of classics races this year. So I think that, again, she might be on a really steep trajectory up and pretty motivated. She will single-handedly affect the outcome of stage three, regardless of where she ends up. I'm looking forward to talking to that. I keep kind of jumping ahead of ourselves, but I think she's a really exciting rider.
Yeah. Absolutely. Let's listen from Georgia Williams from the Team Bike Exchange and how she felt after the stage.
Pretty good. It was sunny weather, so that made it a lot better. Yeah, it was like 92k stage, pretty fast, pretty hectic. But I think Ari finished in seventh. There was a big crash with 10k to go, but luckily we were all on the front on the left, so we all avoided that. And yeah, did a lead out for Ari, and yeah, she did pretty good in the sprint because it was pretty hectic.
What about tomorrow? What are you thinking about tomorrow?
Yeah, tomorrow's going to be the hardest stage so far. It's got a few two categorized climbs, I think, and 108k. But no, like I think maybe it'll be a bit more exciting. So yeah, we're looking forward to that.
So that was Johnny Williams. The Team Bike Exchange, Gracie, how do we rate their performance so far? It's been 3 days. Oh, it's been 2 days and third day's coming up. What can we expect from them from now?
Well, good question. I think they've been a little bit disorganized here and there, unfortunately. Alex Manley did quite a superb job in that lead out on stage two for Ariana, but they, you know, they were just a little bit too early. It was so fast. It was really impressive to see the speed of some of the lead out trains. And when you've only got one person helping a sprinter, it makes it a lot tougher. So I think that they're just going to focus now on breakaways. I think that's their biggest chance now for a stage win. But, you know, they've got some good riders that can get through hilly stages. And stage three is an interesting stage. I would classify it as a hilly stage, but it has an opportunity for a sprinter that can climb okay to get through it, to get to the end, possibly without the likes of Lorena Weber. So this is, could be a really good opportunity for the Bike Exchange squad.
Yeah, absolutely. Kate, take us actually through this stage. This is one of those names that is quite hard for me to pronounce. Tewkesbury, Gloucester. I know Gloucester, it's fine, but yeah, there's too many letters in this. Tewkesbury, this is where we're starting from.
Oh, you know, it's a very rare opportunity we get to kind of laugh at your pronunciation, Christophe. Yeah. You've held my hand through a lot of tours and tut-tut corrected me, so I shan't do that. But Tewkesbury to Gloucester is where we're headed today. 108K, just shy of. You're right, Gracie, I reckon it is more of a kind of climber's day or an aggressive sprinter who is willing to hang on a little bit. There's two Category 2 climbs, and we can see those on the map, those delightful little green mountains. But of note, guys, is the placement of those intermediate sprints, which are both after those QOMs and those climbs. The flavour of the climbs themselves are quite interesting. They're not too long. The first climb is around, and I've got the name written down here, Worrell Hill. It's got such a lovely name. It's like the Wombles or something. And then Speech House. Worrell Hill is only 2 kilometres, but it's averages at 6.1, but actually has some over 10% pinches. Speech House is only 1.3, but has three or four sections that are over 12%. So that's going to be pretty tough too. But interestingly, there's actually a 3 kilometre climb much earlier on in the stage that averages at around 5.8% and isn't categorised at all. So I think that there will be some opportunities for some breakaway riders. And I've got to bring this around because I've been like hanging on at the whole podcast. This is where Nicole Wahoo comes in. Gracie, I reckon Vanderdown, if she is really aggressively going for that red sprint jersey, they're after the QOMs, they are going to be really motivated to either get her in a break or to get other riders in a break and neutralise anybody getting those points.
I think you're right, Kate. I think that the Nicole Wahoo team and the Cams Basso team in particular have been the most active out of all of the teams. And they've also been active at the finales too, which is really cool. They're not just, you know, using all their biscuits in the middle of the race just because they're actually in the race and they're being competitive. But this is that opportunity where that turning point in a tour comes where you have to start thinking about, you know, what the real goals are and what the reality of the situation is and if you want to go for some of those other jerseys. So I think for sure that they're going to be aggressive early on to try and keep getting points towards those categories and those jerseys.
Yeah. Certainly a great stage to watch out for tonight, and it's going to be live on SBS On Demand as well. This is now live on SBS On Demand, so this is great news. We're satisfied by the quality of the broadcast, so we deserve a proper platform. So live on SBS On Demand, like every other stage of this women's tour. There's a question here, and then because we have been scouring the social media, there's a question here from David that says, who had the grandma buzz on stage two, Kate?
Yes.
I'm going to just come in with this one because today is not a grandma buzz, it's an uncle buzz.
I love that. That's our Aussie, of course, Loretta Hansen. Good to see her with some family there. And what's he dressed up as? Streck, like Shrek. I was
Shrek,
like, what
I
is
guess,
that
yeah.
costume? well, look, that is an interesting take on it. I must say he kind of blends in and camouflages with the British woodlands there, but that's good to have the family along. I reckon I've got another grandma buzz moment though.
Yeah, go on.
which is our resident firefighter. And Christophe, I think we've got a bit of a tweet from her here as well. This is Sammy Stewart. And check out who's giving her a little round of applause from the side there, no less than Mark Cavendish. And
Mini Cav.
Human, I know. How good is that?
There's Mini Cav as well.
I love it. And, you know, Sammy Stewart, I just am all over this chick. She's fantastic. She's a firefighter and, like, you know, a bit of a badass one. Can I say that? I just have.
Yeah.
And
okay.
This is her first ever UCI race, not just World Tour race, UCI race. They only signed her a week ago. So she actually came through, got a bit talent ID'd from Zwift Academy, and has been doing a lot on the esports platform around her firefighting shift work. And look at her popping her head up. First UCI race, she's in a break. She's got Cav cheering her on. I mean, this is pretty cool. Like, you, honestly, this is one of the reasons I love the women's side so much. You just don't really get this kind of story coming out of the men's racing. But resident firefighter, I reckon she'd be pretty tough. Good on her.
And also, let's put also a big hand out to Mark Cavendish. He's a massive supporter of women's cycling, and he's been for years, Gracie.
He has. This is not the first time that he's been spotted by the paparazzi out on the course of the women's tour. He's done this in the past. I think he's done it almost every year when he's, you know, not got, he doesn't have a race this week. He's probably hopefully preparing for the tour. Who knows? But yeah, to take family out too. Like, I actually spotted the little boy in the photo. Like, that was what my eye got drawn to before seeing Cav, because the little boy is like a mini Cav. It's super cute and wearing the Quick Step kit. It was gorgeous.
Yeah.
So, yeah, really good. And he tweets about women cycling a lot. This is, you know, an action speaks louder than words. I think that that is really powerful if you can be there in real life, and as well as do all of the nice tweeting that he does. Keep it up, Mark.
And he's Christophe, clearly encouraging everyone, the viewers and the riders. Kate, sorry.
No, I was just going to say, in between all of this work that you're doing, which is a lot, maybe you can whip us up like a little plaster grandma buzz trophy that we can award daily to everybody. I feel like this is a good, fun award to pass on.
Or maybe not, but we'll see. Gracie, you selected this one.
Yeah, it's super cute again. Like, I love all of the kids who come and watch the women's tour. I've talked about it a lot already, but this little girl we used already in our preview show, on the stage one show, she was in another angle on a Canyon Tram post, but in this one, she looks like she's matching the Jumbo Visma team, and just that happy smile. I think that those women made her day, so she'll be buzzing, and I'm sure that she'll want to come again next time. And you know, this kind of thing happens all the time. As I've said before, there's a lot of kids that get to come along and get to meet the riders as well as cheer from the side of the road. And I think that's just such a powerful thing for generations to come in cycling.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, Kate, look what I made earlier. Here it is.
Oh!
That was for the Giro, but we can reuse this one.
You know, yes,
it's got
I
a
like
nice
that.
Nana jumper.
I like that. Yeah, if we just put a little bit of like perm on the head, a little bit of Betty White, and that could go.
Let's
a
do that.
Way.
That I can do. So that would be on Anna Buzz from tomorrow.
Perfect.
We should talk as well about the Dauphiné before we just go, because the Dauphiné is the other race that is happening in France. It's also the other race happening on SBS live every night on your television. Yesterday, we had a very, very interesting finish.
Van Aert, he was dropped. He's fought his way back. The Cofidis colours, this is Benjamin Thomas, but it's Van Aert who is powering over the top, and he doesn't get the win. It looks like Storer who pipped him on the line, or was it Goudou? David Goudou.
Goudou.
It's David Goudou who has delivered the upsets.
That is huge. Van Aert has put his hands up just a split second too soon.
Kate, Van Aert doing an Alaphilippe. It pains me to say that, but he did.
I know it pains you to say that, given the Alaphilippe watch, but, you know, unfortunately, not a lot to watch from him at the moment. Just ego, guys. Like, what a shocker. Oh, I'm a huge Van Aert fan, but you don't need to throw your arms in the air for victory in this kind of sense when it is so close. What was he thinking? He wasn't thinking. I don't know, Gracie. Like, is enough not enough? Like, how many times have we seen this now before he just looks like a turkey?
Actually, I had another question to you, Gracie. Was he thinking, I've got this because he's Goudou, he's never going to outsprint me?
Look, I watched this over and over again as well, and I think Macca and Matt Keenan did a really good job in dissecting it and giving their opinions, and I'm kind of on their side of the fence too, of like, I don't think Van Aert actually did the wrong thing. He only put his hands in the air right at that last meter or two, and in your periphery, you don't see someone coming until you know, they're right beside you. And that was on the line. So, you know, it does make him look bad. And I'm sure he's lost some sleep over it. But I just don't think that he did completely the wrong thing. I think if he'd saluted a couple of meters even before that, then you can definitely call him out on it. But I think this was just a really unfortunate timing. And it's pretty cool for Gadu. I think this is a really great victory for him. You could see in the footage after and in his interview how happy he was. This meant so much to him to take a stage on home soil. So, you know, there was a big win of the day as well as a big loss.
Yeah.
But yeah, Van Aert won't be doing that again. And fun fact, I don't think I've ever saluted for a win because I've always been so nervous about that happening to me that I've always thrown for the line, even if I had a lot of room, because that was always my fear of losing a race like that.
Yeah. I think the rule could almost be like you don't salute unless you're in a solo break or like you're so confident. Like, I don't know, that's what nightmares are made of, I reckon. Ill-fated salute.
And I think the Alaphilippe was even worse, to be honest. Van Aert's a mistake. Alaphilippe was a massive mistake because he really deployed, took his time, and then boom. Anyway.
Yeah, there's a bit of ego in that, but, that's kind of what it takes to be the best too. So we won't criticise too much.
Painful moment. Anyway, let's not stop on this. thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Christophe.
And of course, the women's tour will be on live tonight on SBS On Demand and the Dauphiné as well. Check out your local guides if you want to watch. You can watch both. You know, why not watch one on TV and the other one on your on demand on your telephone? Why not? This is what technology is for. Thank you, Kate. Thank you, Gracie.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Next episode, yes, you're right. Same episode, same place, same time tomorrow.